This video will take a look at using a Costco Jetson e-bike as a transportation solution for building mountain bike trails. So, e-bikes are everywhere these days, and Costco is no exception. They've contracted with Jetson to be either a distributor or an exclusive distributor of the Jetson e-bikes in North America. Meanwhile, I've been racking up way too many miles driving back and forth on trail building sessions over the years. The trails are close enough to my house that I don't have to drive the trail just to ride my bike. But at the same time, I have never felt energetic enough to hump a pack full of tools on my regular bicycle to and from a trail building session. But if I had an e-bike, I could then save the effort required to pedal 10 or 15 kilometers round trip with anywhere from 25 to 40 pounds of tools and water in a backpack. And I'd also be saving a few pounds of CO2 emissions from my car. Now, I wasn't looking for a full-on e-mountain bike that would also serve for trail riding. For starters, an expensive bike like that can't be left out of sight while working on the trail. And for what it's worth, I'm committed to riding trails unassisted. Instead, I wanted an e-bike that was inexpensive and compact so it wouldn't waste space in the garage. Enter the Costco Jetson Haze. This is a folding bike with small 16-inch wheels. It has an advertised range of 25 kilometers, and the price is under $1,000. So those features were an exact match to what I was looking for. I waited and waited for that unit to go on sale, but it never did. So eventually I just bought one. And the question now was, could this device legitimately function as a transportation solution for my trail building? So this is the seat and seat post that comes with the Haze. It's a little on the short side. Nominally 300 millimeters. And for anyone over 5'9", it might not be quite high enough. So what I've got here is a longer post from Amazon. U-Pan bike. Same diameter, 28.6, but it's 450 in length. So we can remove this stock post with a half-inch ratchet. Typical comfort style saddle. So I'm just going to go ahead and put this in to the minimum insertion level. And check the height of that seat from the bottom bracket. It is roughly just under 30 inches, which is almost identical to what I have currently on my mountain bike. So for this Haze bike, the 450 millimeter seat post at minimum insertion is what I would need for my height of just over 6 feet tall for a comfortable stance pedaling. Another slight issue with the bike as delivered from Costco is the rear disc wasn't set up very well, so it's rubbing on the pads. You can hear that rubbing sound. But this rear disc adjustment is done with a couple of bolts which can be loosened. So that's now free to wiggle, rotate, and shift left to right for a very interactive sort of adjustment. So I can kind of look down from the top, try to set it up with a visible gap on either side of the rotor, and tighten these back on. That's considerably better. Okay, so it's not touching the pads. There's an additional adjustment that is possible if needed to adjust the brake. Right here you can see a small 2mm set screw. Just back that off a little bit, open it up, and that allows you to adjust additionally a 5mm Allen bolt on the back side of the caliper reaching through the wheel. Like that. And this adjustment here on this bolt moves the moving pad of the caliper independently of the fixed pad. So if necessary, that is an additional adjustment. I did not need to do it for this current setup, but the whole business of selling bikes through a mass market retailer like Costco inevitably means the customer is going to have to probably figure something out about the brakes, because these mechanical disc brakes do require adjustments. So in my case, it didn't take very long to patch it up. And, you know, if worse comes to worse, you can probably take this bike to any bike shop and get it fixed in just a few minutes. Just something to be aware of when you buy from Costco. So a closer look at that rear shock. FA688, there's no actual brand written on it that I can see. But perhaps I can find something online. Okay, so here's something on Alibaba. A shock that's labeled FA688, the exact same product number. The labeling looks different, and down here in the product description, this shock is rated at 750 pounds per inch. So it looks like Costco Jetson contracted with this company here for a custom order at a higher spring rate, but probably not a much higher price, $2 to $3 a unit. Overall though, I will say, between the shock and the good sized tires, like a 2-inch tire there, and the comfort saddle, the ride is pretty smooth, despite the small 16-inch wheels. So the combination works. There's no front suspension, of course, but with this kind of a setup, most of the weight is over the rear wheels. This bike has a single speed gearing, one chainring, one cog, and there's no other gearing. Something I noticed pretty quickly after just a few short rides is there's friction in the rear hub. So if I just go and gently spin the front wheel, that's what I expect from ball bearings. Same push here, one revolution, or less even.
So that friction in the rear hub is basically the consequence of it being a direct drive DC motor. The cog is directly attached to the rotor of the motor, and when you're pedaling without any throttle, back EMF in that motor is opposing your pedaling force and creating that friction. I thought perhaps there was a chance at this price point, maybe you had a regenerative circuit in there So the battery was getting recharged. I tried to contact technical support about that. It started with a chat bot. I got past the chat bot to an associate in a call center. The associate eventually agreed to forward my question to actual technical support, but I never heard back. So I think it's fair to assume there is no regenerative circuit in this motor. It's just back EMF, and the pedaling as a result is compromised. You would not want to have to pedal this bike a kilometer to get home if the battery ran out. You might do 500 meters, but much more than that, you're going to be parking the bike and coming back to pick it up with the car. That's all there is to it. For my purposes, I'm running a very similar route every time I go out, and I know it's well within the capability of the battery, so it works for me, but it might not work for everybody, and it's a surprising choice. I can't believe it would have been that much more money to get a freewheel into that hub motor.
The battery can be extracted using the provided key. I guess you've got to use this little handle here to pull it out. Battery can be recharged either in the bike or out of the bike, which is convenient. The weight of the battery is 5 pounds, 6 ounces. Okay, so we're gonna load hip here for a little trail building. Got the saw. The shovel. Batteries for the saw. Handsaw. Earmuffs. And that's about it. So that's about 20-25 pounds. Sidewalk here, so I've got it dialed down to first speed. Take it slow and safe. We're hitting the bike lane now, so I can crank it up to 3. And on this grade, we're just coasting. No fly. Take it down to 1 for this little obstacle. Mm-hmm. onto the rail trail. So here's the entrance to the park. Normally this is open for vehicle parking, except during the winter it's now gated off. But I can still get in here with the e-bike. So I just brought a short length of chain, stashed the bike here. So the first thing I got to take out today is this deadfall tree blocking the alignment. Okay, so here's a look at the bench that got done. That's the tree I cut out right there. And put down some rubble to kind of shore up a little bit and make a tread. And then leveled it out with some off the side and fresh earth as well from elsewhere. So for today, we're gonna try to fix the line on this little slope. Using this piece of dead trunk here. See the extension of that line? Okay, so I got that big log supported with two pieces of concrete rubble, and the alignment that will be created here should initiate a right-hand turn for the rider to avoid hitting this sapling and avoid hitting that sapling, while also moving to the right enough to avoid hitting that sapling right there and being far enough over to the right to line up the bottom of the gully right there. So this giant piece of dead trunk is going to guide that alignment. there's a quick backfill. I'll do more on this later. But this is just to get it started. Here's something else I found digging. I've seen a surprising number of people who will be out with the metal detectors, just walking up and down the valley, totally randomly, searching for buried treasure. This is the coolest thing I've found. Milk wagon, license number 356 from 1965. Wow. All right, headed back the way we came. This is why I wanted the e-bike, climbing out of the valley. It's probably 75 to 100 feet of elevation. And I got 25 pounds of tools and stuff on the back. Okay, so uncovered one slight problem with these folding pedals. The mechanism is there's a latch on the inside here, which you pull in like that to release the pedal and allow it to flip up. That latch is now stuck in the in position. And if you were to try to pedal with it stuck, the pedal would just flop down like that every time. So the problem is riding with these boots that are just totally caked in mud. The mud is getting into this pedal latch space and causing a lot of friction. So I've already started using this jiggaloo to try to release the friction a bit, like that. Oh, that worked. Okay. Now it's operating freely again. So what are the recommendations after the first few rides on the bike? Amongst the pros, I'd say the price point and all-around functionality are just a perfect match for trail building, exactly what I was looking for. And this thing is a legit folding bike. It's very compact for storage in the garage. Amongst the cons, of course, the back EMF in the direct drive hub motor is regrettable. And I really don't know how service and warranty issues might be resolved by either Jetson or Costco. So, on the balance, I'm really happy with this bike, and I expect to use it many times over the coming years.